good morning. Hey, how about let's all stand, and before we begin our song worship, worship with songs, how about let's just spend a minute or two, just say hi to your neighbors, walk around a little bit, talk to people maybe you know already, and also talk to people. You have to talk to people you haven't talked the last couple of weeks too. Yeah, shall we do that? Yes, we shall. So let's do that right now. Say hi to people, give them a holy hi, fist bump. Yes, we have a new friend named Jamie. All right. Well, you guys ready? Let's start with the prayer. How about that? Father, we just thank you for this beautiful morning that you've gathered all of us here today, Lord, under one roof, and to sing a few songs, Lord, to think about what you have done in our life and continue to do, Lord, and that we may take these songs and then use them as a praise and worship before the holy throne, Lord. So I just pray that you will open our hearts right now, and Lord, I pray that our life would reflect what we sing today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth.
Early in the morning.
Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. And as I stumble through the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
God of wonders,
God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
Let's sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. 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 God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonders, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
Father, you're holy, Lord. You're not like any one of us, Lord. You're awesome. You're almighty. You're omniscient, all-knowing. You're all-powerful. We praise you, Lord. Let's praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more, stronger than darkness. New every morn, our sins they are many, his mercy is more. What love could remember no wrongs we have done, omniscient, all knowing, he counts not their son. Throw into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, morn, our sins they are many, his mercy is more. What patience will wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn, our sins they are many, his mercy is more. What riches of kindness lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood near the death we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more.
praise you, Lord. Our sins are many, but your mercy is more. Yes, Lord, we confess that our hearts, even though we confess that we are believers, we're followers, Lord, but our hearts, we do still roam around. Lord, we're not 100% loving you and others, Lord. But this morning, Lord, we come before you at the throne of grace, Lord. We praise you. We praise for your mercy. We praise you for your grace. That is in Christ, Lord. Because without him, Lord, we do not have the access to the Father. We do not have the freedom from the bondage of sin, Lord. And we have no grace. So we thank you for giving us your Son. There is a Redeemer, Jesus God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, all for sinners slain. Good morning, and I think we can have the worship team come down now. thought there was no MC, but Kim is the MC. Go ahead.
See, but today the speaker is my dad, Mr. David again. So let's welcome him up. Yeah, I'm gonna. He has to listen to me, at least for a few seconds. So let me pray for him and he can start. Do you wanna turn around? Okay. Dear Laura, thank you so much for gathering us here today to worship you and learn more about you. Please bless the speaker. I know you already talked to him when he's preparing, but also, bless him as he expresses what he prepared, and also open our ears and hearts to understand what you have for us today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you. And thank you, Richard. That was wonderful, the worship. I mean, we do depend upon the Lord. And so what I'm going to speak about today, though, is something I'm going to preach to myself, talk to myself. Not that I talk to myself, I do talk to myself often, but it's the best topic is when we talk to ourselves. And so this topic is about procrastination, right? So let's have the team, okay, first the next slide, please. Okay, let's, K&B Productions is back, yay! All right, so. All right, we are amateurs, so please give us a little bit of slack. Cut us a little bit of slack on this. Whoops, sorry. Don't comment on the acting. We're trying our best. Okay, so do you want me to sit here or no? All right, so. All right, this is David, and this is Mom, and this is Dad. So we are finishing dinner. We're finishing dinner, eating up, and then it's, 6:30. Okay, and so, we speak Chinese at home, so we're going to do that here, okay? So, you want me to say one?
我们要睡了，你不洗碗，你要留到明天早上吗？哎，我不管了，我就睡了。你还是你要我洗，我可以帮你洗一次啊。你说什么？哦，好，可以，没问题。我觉得好可怜啊，身为父母这么失败，没有什么威严。
So mom and dad have gone to sleep, and so we can hear
okay, that we can put them off, right? And so let's give Mom and Dad a big hand. Yay! Thank you. That was good acting, especially. I know they're getting less nervous about it. So acting, by the way, is not hard, especially if it's something that you recognize in yourself. And so a lot of these we try to do are things that we do ourselves. All right, next one, next slide. All right, so procrastination, what does that mean? I know you can say it in China, some people can say it in Chinese, toyan, but what does it mean? Oh, sorry, Wilson. Eternity in one day. Yes, we put off things, right? All right, so next slide, please. So it's the action of delaying or postponing something. I will do that tomorrow, someday, right? Anyone ever think this or do this? Probably everyone has, right? Next slide, please. Okay, so, probably everyone has, right? At one time or another. But some people are better at it than others. And I'm not especially good at procrastinating, but I have put off things, right? Because I think, I'll do it. All right, so next slide, sorry. Thank you. All right, so there's even a procrastinator's club motto. Okay, I didn't realize this. I looked this up on the web, okay, and there is a procrastinator's club. And they have a motto, never do today what can be put off till tomorrow, right? And so they have for an application, I'm embarrassed to say this is from my hometown, Philadelphia. They have a membership fee, and you're entitled to an official membership card, a license to procrastinate, a recent calendar, and last month's newsletter, right? So you notice last month's newsletter, right? So it's something it's funny because it's something that's in all of us, right? I was looking for a C.S. Lewis quote, I couldn't find it, unfortunately, but Wormwood, who is a representative of Satan, said, I don't worry about it. You don't need to convince them not to accept Christ or to look to God. Just have to convince them to do it tomorrow, right? Because if they do it tomorrow, they won't do it, right? And so, all right, next slide, please. All right, and that's me, okay? So, as I said, I'm speaking to myself. If you look up my last name in procrastination on Google Scholar, I actually wrote at least two, maybe more papers with a colleague on this topic. So you can find that. All of us procrastinate about what we should do some of the time, and some of us procrastinate much of the time, right? When someone comes and says, oh, come on, can you clean up the table? Can you take the garbage out? Can you clean out the bathroom? Our first response is, yay, let me do it right now, right? No? Okay, probably not. it depends. But of course it depends, right, upon the sound. Like I noticed with our family, the sound of Beard Papa's puffs is easier to recognize than wash the dishes. For some reason, I can call that once, and everyone comes out, yes, I can do it. But wash the dishes, take out the trash, no. Right, but I can procrastinate good things too, and I'll talk about this. When I get something good, a good result, like so, sometimes a friend, an old friend, will send an email, a message to me, and I'll delay reading it because I want to sort of, well, it's good. Let me wait. But unfortunately, time slips by. I had a chess set. I don't know if anyone plays chess here. Xiangqi. Oh, you do? Okay, all right. I'll have to bring this in. It was from Africa, and a friend who was witnessing there had sent it, and I said, someday I'm going to open up this chess set and use it. And then I found it in boxes, and I realized, 10 years had passed by. I didn't do it. All right, next slide. All right, so we're going to talk about what the Bible says about procrastination and then what happens in our family. Okay, and so I'm going to pray just to begin. Let's pray here. Heavenly Father, we know that some things are in us. It's part of our sin nature. And to put things off is part of our sin nature. And so please lead and guide as we look at your word and what you have to say about that, what happens, and what, and also about what it did in our family as well. Not progressing. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name I pray this. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, what does the Bible say about procrastination? There's two verses I'd like, two areas I'd like to share. Next slide, please. All right, so we just finished, right? Esther and Haman. And so what did the Jews face with Haman in Persia? Remember? What was going to happen to the Jews if Esther didn't do what she was supposed to do? They were going to, remember, they were going to wipe out all of them, right? And she, what, do you remember what she did? She went into the, how easy, I forget. You guys know. Last week or 2 weeks ago, they went in, what did Esther have to do? Convince the king, right, of Persia, right? But if the king was displeased, who knows? She went in too quickly, right? What could happen to Esther? She could be executed. Yeah, not tomorrow, right then and there, okay? So it involved risks. And could she have procrastinated? Yes. She could have said, well, it's dangerous. Maybe I'll do it someday. All right, next one. Next slide. All right, so God gives us opportunities. He says, here's something for you to do, okay, the challenge. So Mordecai, okay, her uncle sort of, said, do not imagine that because you are the king's palace, you alone will escape the fate of all the Jews. So everyone everywhere would be eliminated. And guess what? We would not have Jesus today, right? So God would definitely carry out his purpose, but through another person, right? So if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. So God's going to work his purpose, regardless of whether we take advantage of opportunities in our lives. But, okay, you and your father's house will perish, right? So God, when God tells us to do something, what's the right time to do it? Now, right? Not tomorrow, not the next day. And again, I'm speaking to myself. I'm not speaking to any of you, right? But now, and so who knows if perhaps you have come to this kingdom, to the kingdom for such a time as this, okay? And God brings us into places for such a time as this. He's placed you here. I think Connie, Miss Connie, right? She spoke about that, is that you're here. God will place you in places for such a time as this, right? Next one. So, did Esther delay? No, she sent this reply to Mordecai. Go and assemble all the Jews who can be found in Susa, its capital, and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, right? Remember we talked about fasting. I think we talked about fasting, right? Fasting before you do something big. It's good, actually, although I find it hard to do. You have to work on it, but fasting can be good. Fasting is what? The act of not eating, right? Okay, fasting is not eating. So it's focusing your mind on what God has for you. After that, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish, right? And we all know that she succeeded, right? So the Jews were saved. So God gave something to Esther to do, and it worked out. Okay. Although, again, if you were in her shoes, if you think about it, it would be tough, right? Because you're like, if he's not pleased, I'll die. Okay, next one. Next slide, please. All right, so reasons we do not act when we should, all right, and this is from my own experience. You can probably bring up other reasons, right, is laziness. This is mine, right? Okay, I say, oh, I don't want to do it right now. Do I really want to clean the backyard now? Do I really want to straighten my notes or do my grading, right? I just finished grading for a summer course, right? It's not fun, even though students think it's fun for teachers to grade, but it's actually not fun. Fear, right? Sometimes people fear things, so they don't act immediately, right? So, well, if I put it off, this is probably Esther. She could have a good reason for fear, right? She's afraid, but if I just put it off until the future, then it'll be okay. Tomorrow will never come. Or Another thing I've seen is, am I worthy? Me? Really? I remember bringing, I won't say who it was, but it was into a prayer meeting, and there were a lot of important people in the church, and I had someone with me who said, oh, we shouldn't go in there. Are we worthy to go in there? And the pastor said, Caleb said, to his credit, I know, they welcome people in there to pray. Okay, next slide, please. All right, so distractions we can see from another book, which I think we're going to do soon, right? So distractions mean what if you're distracted? So if you're concentrating, right? If you're writing a paper, if you're doing your homework, do you want to just focus on that? No. I mean, there's always, it's always like the, all of a sudden, sweeping the floors, cleaning the, arguing with your little brother, whatever, all of a sudden looks good, right? So, but you have to learn to say no when necessary, right? Nehemiah, I know you guys have looked at Nehemiah. Nehemiah did what? Anyone remember? I don't think it's recent. Nehemiah built the wall. Okay, so he was around the same time, right? When the Jews came back to Jerusalem, the wall was destroyed. And God said, you need to rebuild the wall. And so, is rebuilding a wall fun? No, it's like, well, rebuilding a wall, right? Like cutting the grass or what other labor. So it isn't fun, right? But other people were trying to distract them. Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message. Come, let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono. Sounds like a Japanese name, but not. So wanted to just sit down and have tea or coffee, or they didn't actually have those beverages at the time, but they wanted to relax, right? Is that all it was? No. They were trying to distract. But they were scheming. Notice the next verse. But they were scheming to harm me. So I sent messengers down to them with this reply. I'm carrying on a great project and cannot go down. So, and each time they came and said, oh, come on, join us out for food, coffee, whatever. And he said, no, I have to get done my homework, right? And so, and so then the fifth time they started threatening him and say, hey, come on, if you don't come and stop the work, we're gonna make a report, a false report, and tell the king that you're plotting to revolt against him, right? So they were just trying to distract him. And so when you're trying to do work or something important that God has given you, or your homework, right, which is important, in school, you want to focus on the homework, right? It's so easy. Maybe you're not like me, but it's so easy to get distracted, right? Our family is probably a little bit guodongde, but but even if you're not, it's easy to get distracted. Next slide. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about this with respect to our family. So I'm going to share, okay, something from us, okay, and why we are who we are. All right, so I know some of you are homeschooling. Yay! Not that it's everything, okay, but homeschooling is good. It's cool. And so we're happily homeschooling in Southern California. And we had a homeschool group, and Kimberly went to one homeschool university. University prepared the curriculum, and Benjamin is going to another. And I know some of you go to a classics one, which is good too. And so they trusted in Christ, and they could be semi-bilingual, okay, because we spoke Chinese at home to them, and we watch soap operas, very good drama. And from Taiwan and mainland China. And so, but I thought to myself, okay, let me give it a shot to apply to be a Fulbright scholar. Now, I never expected to succeed, okay? Because a lot of people apply, hundreds of people apply, depends upon the country. So especially for good countries, we apply to Taiwan, hundreds of people may apply and only a few succeed, only one succeeds. And so I thought, oh, well, I'll give it a shot, and it doesn't matter, right? It's a procrastination. Someday I would like to do that. I would like to live there and to be a professor at the university. Now, if I was a failure, OK, Okay, I'd be like, yes, I tried, good. That's I can pat myself on the back, right? But unfortunately, I was successful. It was successful. No, I was successful. It was successful. So I thought, oh no, I have to pull up root, okay, and then bring everyone over to Taiwan to live for a long while. So I had to think about it. Do it now or admit failure, right? So we had a full scholarship, and some people at, I know some of you may know Zhengzhi Dashi, had recommended me, and so I thought, oh, I gotta do it. So no procrastination, do it now, right? If I don't do it now, I can't, I won't get the award, right? Next slide. So we answer the call, right? Now, at the beginning of the slides, okay, those of you who studied Latin, tell me what carpe diem means. I know some of you are. I won't point out anyone in particular. Oh, okay, we won't point out. Kimberly is pointing someone out, but I don't know if you studied this phrase, so we don't want to embarrass anyone. Carpe diem. No? It sounds like that, doesn't it? Okay, carpe diem means seize the day. Okay, and what it means is to take advantage of opportunities. There's a good book by this name too, by the way. All right, and so it means to take advantage of opportunities that God may give you. All right, so after much prayer and discussion, these letters are really small, I apologize, the three of us, a second grader and a sixth grader at the start, uprooted our lives and moved to Taiwan. Okay? Not everyone could do it because their mom couldn't do that. She was working at a job. So we felt that that is what God wanted. And so we thought, all right, it's because there's only one time. I know some of you have learned, you're in between languages, right? Some of you speak almost only English and some of you speak almost only Chinese. And so we thought, well, but there's a certain time where you can learn and you don't sound like a foreigner. So I can speak Chinese, Mandarin Chinese pretty well, but no one will ever mistake me for a native speaker, right? Because when I was younger, I grew up in the US. So we all felt that was what was God wanted. So we flew over there, you know what that's like, right? What do you get when you fly overseas to mainland China or Taiwan? The first night, are you able to go to sleep? No, right? You have jet lag. So I said, all right, in this hotel room is what you've had. Out there is what God has for us in the future. And I don't know what it is. But so I said, all right, so we need to pray and then go ahead and meet what is out there. So, and I knew the language and culture experiences, right, are important. So, by the way, value the language and culture of your parents, right, because that's important. When you grow up, you'll find out why. So I felt that don't take it, and God will find someone else to do it. So I thought, all right, well, so we went ahead and we took the opportunities. Every opportunity that God, well, not every, almost every opportunity that God offered to us. And we had, first of all, right, and this is true for all things that God calls you to do. We had, number one, we had lots of fun, right? So it is lots of fun. Have any of you lived? I guess you have, sort of. You're going to go with Miss Connie. She's going to bring people over to Taiwan on a missions trip, right? But I don't think, when was the last time that occurred? What's that? Before COVID. All right, a long, long time ago, right? All right, well, we had lots of fun. We had the Taiwan hosts, which is Fulbright, which is like their State Department, and the university, Zhengzhi Dashi, and the schools treated us very well. Okay, Kimberly and Benjamin went to the school attached to Zhengzhi Dashi, Shi and Guoxia. Right, and so we had Benjamin and Kimberly also met the ambassadors and diplomats, and it was a fun time. But I'm going to talk about that slide. But and a good friend. Okay, so part of what we did is to be a witness for Christ, right? And so we've had lots of experiences. It's been many, many years over the years, and so one good friend of Kimberly's accepted Christ because of seeing her over there and getting to know her, right? And at the end of the academic year, I took them all after they were, because it's hard. You have to remember, you guys go into school, right? So we understand the experience. So they went directly from English curriculum, with some speaking Chinese at home, into a school in Taiwan where everything was in Chinese. And they did pretty well, but they worked hard, right? So at the end of the academic year, we took them all to a Xiu Shen Nong Chang, which is a leisure farm. We're gonna see pictures of those. So it was fun. So they worked hard. At the end of the year, you could take them and have their reward, so to speak. Next slide, please. Okay. However, as with anything, there is some pain and sadness. So, because tough times, because being away, again, have you been away at home or from home for any length of time? Some of you probably have, so you know what I'm talking about. So we understand that, right? So tough times are not that bad when you're far away. That's what we found, right? So we had, and I'll interject and explain the pictures here. So one is we had a fall. I think Benjamin fell, and his head went into a hospital. And so that was tough, but we got through it together. We prayed together, and he recovered. And Kimberly, I won't tell how exactly, injured herself. and she sent a line to me with a picture saying, "Baba, 我看不见." Both of her eyes were covered. So I guess think she had somehow gotten herself shot with a BB gun. And so, but you know, if you pray and you trust in God, you can get through tough times like that. And that's one of the things I've noticed. It isn't that bad being far away in tough times. However, loneliness is a factor, right? When you're away from your parents, did you feel lonely at times? Probably, right? If you think about it, I know that all of us have, right? Because we're not near the people we love, right? So, and that good times are tough too. That's what I found. Bad times are not tough when you meet challenges, but good times are tough. So sometimes, I know Benjamin got like a really good score in his writing exam. Benjamin likes writing. If any of you need experience in writing, seek him out. Kimberly likes math and speaking, and so she always got good scores. But it's tough because you don't have time to share it. You can't share it with people you care about. And so I remember one time Kimberly would just start crying, and nothing I could say, right? Just pray about it. We would pray about it, but nothing I could say because I got a great score, I have a good friend or whatever, but she's far away from the people she cares about. And so the Bible talks about as they pass through the valley of tears, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. So God takes our tears, takes the hard times, and makes them into good things. One of the good things in this picture, does anyone recognize? Probably couldn't recognize this area, but I think Taiwan Keqi Dashi. And we used to go there. This is a friend of, a classmate of Kimberly's, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. An older classmate of Kimberly's. And he would play soccer with Benjamin, who was a real soccer, was a fanatic at that age. Right? So God takes the tears. When you do something, it's not only all going to be smooth, right? When you take a challenge, but God can take our difficult times and turn them into something good. So, in the next slide, the blessings. We learned a lot over the years, right? So we are in some ways very similar to you. You may not think so because we're perhaps racially different, but culturally and experience-wise, we have a lot of similarities because we've adjusted to other cultures. We've both been, at times, aliens in a foreign culture. So we learned a language and a culture. We learned what it is like to be an immigrant. I had a Zhuliao Shen Fen at times, which is a green card in Taiwan. And we liked it enough that we thought of staying because as I staying on as a position at Zhengzhi Dashi, I was offered that. So, but most important, I think, is that we could understand the challenges of a broader range of people. So when we come back, coming back here, we can understand, right? We did, before we came to DEC, we did ministry at USC with international students. We could say to them, we understand what you're going through, okay? And that is a blessing. Anyone tell me where this is? Oh, I have it in my backpack, which of course I didn't bring with me up here on the stage. Or did I? Kimberly might know it. Miss Kimberly might know it. Shueba Nongcheng. It's this is 9,000 feet above sea level. It's very beautiful. You gotta just go to the Xiuxian Nongcheng in Taiwan when you do that. But if you go there, but it's this is where clouds were coming in, and we saw a double rainbow. We saw a double rainbow coming in. That's pretty cool. All right, next slide. All right, and the blessings are work together as a family. Okay, so we work together because if we didn't, we would perish, right? I mean, or at least we would fail. Oh, here it is. Here it is. Okay, so, right, and then this is, all right, so we work together as a family so we could complement each other's strengths and weaknesses. I won't talk about, you probably know us well enough by now to know what our strengths and weaknesses are. And Benjamin and Kimberly are complementary. So we used that one time, is that I think, a cell phone got lost on the bus. I won't talk about who left it there, but it was it went to the mountains, and and so Benjamin, who was very careful about that, saying, oh, "Let me try to use Google to find the cell phone." And so it rang in the middle of the night, and we found it. Okay, so losing a cell phone is tough. I mean, if we lost it here, it would be gone. So, what's that? Forever, yeah, it would be gone. If we did this in Los Angeles, it would be gone forever. All right, so we worked together at USC, and we did so coming to DEC, okay, and hopefully we will continue to do so here. And so God can take, if we meet a challenge, it's not gonna be easy. So if you meet a challenge, God gives you a challenge, it may not be easy, but if you continue and are not afraid to embrace it, okay, he can bring blessings into your lives. By the way, these are so beautiful. This is also in the mountains. All right, so one more slide here. Okay, takeaway. Anyone recognize this one? How many people from Taiwan background? This is Jiaofeng Nongcheng. And so it was beautiful. It was at night. So the takeaway is do what God has given you to do. Carpe diem, seize the opportunity, right? Value it. There's a picture I didn't show here, but there's a fake piano, and it's flower, field of flowers they're playing. Start it when God gives you the opportunity to do so. Do not procrastinate, all right? And most of all, do not give up, okay? You're gonna see in other Bible stories, right, where people try to, like Nehemiah, right? They try to encourage him to give up. Ah, give it up, don't worry about it. You'll never finish the wall. Don't give it up what God has given you to do, and don't procrastinate. All right, we're 1 minute over time. So let's close in prayer for this. Heavenly Father, I don't know what challenges and opportunities you have laid out for everyone here, but I pray that they meet the opportunity, and I pray that you can help them to carpe diem, seize the day, because I know you want to bless each and every one in a different way. Thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name I pray this. Amen.
Hello, everyone. My name is Daisy, and welcome back to our DEC Kids News. Now, let's take a look at the news reading this week. Last Friday, on July 1st, the church held a churchwide prayer meeting of worship with one heart and uniting of generations. That night, the adults and children of the worship group came to church early to prepare themselves, and the intercession group also prayed for the worship that evening's meeting. Many families and parents from the church. the youth group cooperated with Pastor Caleb for exact translation. The closing prayers of each stage were led by a mother and a daughter or a father and a son. Watching the parents and children lay hands on each other and pray with one heart. We can't help but pray to God. Bow down to worship His grace and wish Him to continue to do the work of generational unity in DEC and every family, so that God's name may be exalted and God's heart will be satisfied. On July 3rd, last Sunday, Davina, a child of the Children's Church, was baptized into the name of Jesus Christ under the witness of her parents and became a child of God. Glory to God. May God bless Davina. Continue to dedicate to the Children's Church to know God better in the truth of the Bible and grow with roots and foundations in life. Do you still remember the prosperous and joyful scenes of VBS last year? VBS will be back this summer. This time, the theme is Doomerang. The time is from July 25th to July 29th, every night from 7 to 9 p.m. Welcome the children who will be promoted from K to 6. And come join us. Let us experience the wonderful journey of God's Word through lively forms of worship, Bible stories, games, crafts, and more. Please go to the church's website to sign up to participate. The number of spots is limited. Parents, please register as soon as possible. On July 16, Saturday, from the afternoon to evening, family activities will be open to all youth families, including younger siblings. The time is from 4 p.m. to 9 p.m. We could play with water, have dinner, and watch a movie together. Everyone is encouraged to participate. That's our news this week. Thanks for watching, everyone. See you next week. Bye!
Bye. Okay, great job, Daisy. So, just a few reminders of, I know a lot of information has been, you've processed a lot of information. So one reminder, so the barbecue or the water playing event is next Saturday. The 16th is next Saturday. So please come, and if you have parents that like to cook, please tell them to, you know, do a little potluck if possible. Contact Tracy for that. So before we go into big picture, and I'm asking you to do some stretches, let's welcome our newcomer today. His name is Jamie, and can you stand up and introduce yourself? So I would like to ask your name, school, grade, and the first thing you do in the morning. I've been creative in my questions, so. All right, here is a mic.
So how do I start off? So I'm 14 years old, and I'm in Wilson High School. It's in Hacienda Heights. Yeah, I live in Hacienda Heights. So then that's the first thing I do in the morning. Just brush my teeth, as soon as I wake up.
All right. Today we don't have small group, we have just the lesson. So let's stand up and do some stretches as we wait for Ruth to come up. Maybe Ruth can lead us in some stretches. I don't know if she exercises. She does this.
I'm very loud. Yeah. Okay. All right, let me prepare myself. Today, we will use 45 minutes to introduce the background of the New Testament. Speaking of the background of the New Testament, we must refresh our memory of the Old Testament. And also, we would like to see one of the books in the center of the Bible. Last time I mentioned that book, this is my homework, this is the homework. That book is the Psalm, all right? That book is the Psalm. Psalm contains 150 selected hymns. It is about the story of the Israel. And the story about Israel is also the story about God. And we're going to learn, and also we're going to refresh what we have learned in the past 3 months. Imagine that. The big picture has passed 3 months, and we have one more month. I believe in the middle of August, around August 14, we will finish the big pictures class. And after that, we will have celebration, okay? And let's pray. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for this opportunity again. We can come together and learn your word and also learn your history and learn the story about yourself. Help us to focus on this 45 minutes. I know it is short, but we are going to refresh our memory for thousands of years of the history of Hebrew. Thank you for your the word is your word is our life, and your word is the fire. And I ask the Holy Spirit to be with us at this moment. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So let me see. Is this here? All right. Every nation often to use its own language to write down the thought or the feeling that have been refined over time into beautiful poems and become the most part of the human culture. And the Hebrew nation has its own poetry as far as or as long as the Bronze Age. But not until King David's time, the poetry flourished, all right, due to its popularity. Poetry is not only to use to tell the history, to tell God history, but also to praise the Heavenly Father who created all things and who created human beings. All right, and also Hebrew use the poetry to pray, to give thanks, to repent. So with the unique characteristic, what is the unique characteristic? That Hebrews history is God history. And Hebrews history reflect in the Hebrews poetry. So with this very unique characteristic, Hebrew poetry has long been a treasure of mankind. And the Psalm contains 150 selected hymns. And this is a great collection of the hymns for Jewish nation long before the birth of the Christ. And the people, Jewish people, they sang the hymn, the poetry, in the temple. They sang the hymn in the major festival. They sang the hymn on the way for the pilgrim's journey. And they even sing when they are mourning, right? So the singing of the hymn has become the major characteristic of the early church. And even Christian, we are joyful crowd because we love singing, right? We love singing. And also we enjoy the sweet time, the sweet fellowship time with our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. David was a shepherd boy who grew up on the prairie. So he likes the music by nature. So when he became the king, he established a tradition. And this tradition is loving the poetry for the nation. The Israelites have suffered for thousands of years. They have experienced the slavery from the Egypt, the wandering in the wilderness, discord between the brothers, division of the country, even the captivities in the foreign country. However, they also personally experienced the salvation from God. All right, they are saved, they escaped from Egypt, entered the Canaan, and built the nation, and also built the temple, and also returning to their homeland, etc. And the thousands of years of the history, there are endless of the tears, there are endless of the gratitude, and all the tears and all the gratitude had become the points, turned into the points that have been passed down to the generation. And the most important and the most glorious things in the psalm is the messianic prophecy. For thousands of years, Israelite, they are longing for the ever righteous kingdom. They are longing for the peaceful and the just king, and that is called the Messiah. And they are waiting for this Messiah to save them. That is the final part of the age. And the Messiah finally come of the age of the Jesus Christ. And the next one, we are going to see the video about the song, the background of the song. And I hope this video will give us a better understanding of the background of the book of the Psalm, and also it may refresh our memory what we have learned about the Old Testament, Hebrew history. All right, let's watch this video.
We've been talking about poetry in the Bible, how biblical poets. We've been talking about poetry in the Bible, how biblical poets love design and masterfully use metaphor and symbolism. These poems invite us into an experience, to ponder ideas slowly and from many angles.
And the largest...
We've been talking about poetry in the Bible, how biblical poets love design and masterfully use metaphor and symbolism. These poems invite us into an experience, to ponder ideas slowly and from many angles.
And the largest collection of poetry in the Bible is the Book of Psalms. So that's what we're going to look at here.
Now, the Israelites composed lots of poetry throughout their history.
Yeah, poems were written by Israelites, sages, kings, and prophets. Some poems were sung by choirs in the Jerusalem temple, while others were prayed by families at home. And over the centuries, the most important and widely read poems were compiled together to be read or sung on special occasions.
And I'm familiar with books of poetry, a large collection of the greatest poems in one place, and I can read through and pick my favorites.
But the Book of Psalms isn't that kind of collection. Here, each poem has been expertly crafted and then placed where it is for a reason, to create a storyline from the book's beginning to its end. The Psalms poetically retell the entire biblical story, and they invite you into a literary temple.
A literary temple?
Yeah, so the tabernacle, and then later the temple in Jerusalem, were where ancient Israelites went to meet with God. When you arrived, you would see art and imagery everywhere. You'd see priests performing rituals, you'd hear songs and prayers, all of it symbolically proclaiming that your God rules the world from this mountain and you're in his living room.
So the temple was a place to be in God's presence and also to immerse yourself in the story of God's kingdom.
Exactly. And so try to imagine how traumatic it was when the Babylonians invaded Jerusalem, plundered and burned the temple, and then took many Israelites into exile.
Yeah, where can they go now to meet with God, to sing their story and say their prayers?
That's where the Book of Psalms comes in. It's a prayer book for exiles, designed as a virtual temple. You enter the Psalms to meet with God and to hear the entire biblical story of God's kingdom sung back to you in poetry.
Cool, but how does the Psalms do it?
Let's start with the book's design. There are 150 poems broken up into five clear sections. At the beginning, there's been placed a short introduction, Psalms 1 and 2, which lay out the main themes of the whole book by reviewing the biblical storyline.
Okay.
Psalm 1 looks back to the Garden of Eden and its river of life.
Yeah, God placed humanity in a garden temple. And here, humans decide to define good and evil on their own terms, and so are exiled from the garden.
But the first psalm paints a portrait of hope, about an upright human who delights in God's wisdom, which is called Torah, or instruction. This person is like the tree of life in the garden temple. They eternally blossom because they're planted in the river of God's life.
Yeah, that's beautiful, but who's it supposed to be?
Well, remember that story in Genesis. After humanity's foolish rebellion, God made a promise.
Oh right, a future human, the seed of the woman who would come and defeat evil and restore the world.
And that's what Psalm 2 is about. God's promise that a king would come from the line of David. He's called the Son of God and the Messiah. God appoints him to bring justice on human evil and to restore God's kingdom and peace over the nations.
So Psalms 1 and 2 introduce all these main themes.
Yes, and then the book develops those themes through the five sections. The first two explore the complicated story of David and his royal family. The third section focuses on the tragedy of Israel's exile and the downfall of David's royal line. But then the fourth and fifth sections rekindle the hope for the Messiah, a new temple, and God's kingdom on the other side of the exile. Then the book ends with a five-part conclusion, praising God for his faithfulness.
Cool. Now, nearly half of the Psalms are connected to one guy, King David, who God chose to rule Israel.
Yes, David's story is really important in this book. He experienced many times of hardship, but he trusted God with radical faith. And in these poems, David shares his fears, confesses his failures, and offers thanks to his Redeemer. And he's constantly speaking of a deep longing to be in God's presence in the temple.
But wait, David lived before the temple was even built.
Exactly. This portrait of David, hoping and praying for God's kingdom and a future temple, it resembles the hopes of the later generations of the exiles. And so, David's prayers could become theirs as well.
David's like a prayer coach, giving us words for how to pray and how to discover God's presence in good times and bad.
Exactly. There are 73 poems connected to David, but most of the rest come from later generations of biblical poets, and they have learned to pray and hope like David. And so the end result is the Book of Psalms, designed as a virtual temple for all generations of God's people.
This isn't a kind of book you just read once and put down.
No, it's designed for a lifetime of slow rereading and reflection. These prayers and laments and songs of praise are meant to become our own. They're poems for exiles who are learning to live by God's wisdom and to seek God's justice in the world as they hope for the coming Messiah and the kingdom of God.
Thank you. Right, does that give you some idea what you have learned in the past 3 months? So, in the Psalm, it records thousands of years of the Hebrew history. And of course, Psalm was written in what language? Hebrew or Greek? Hebrew, okay? The next video, I'm going to introduce you a song, all right? And this song is from the Book of Psalm and chapter 23, The Lord is My Shepherd. I know many of you have read, even some of you can memorize the whole chapter. Who can remember the whole chapter? The Lord is my shepherd, all right? It's okay. All right. But if you have time when you go home, you read this Psalm 23rd. All right. And this has become the worldwide, the Christian like to read it, the Jewish people like to read it, even non-Christian like to read it, because this is the comforting psalm. Okay. And it is sung in Hebrew. All right, so shall we listen to this video song? The Lord is my shepherd. And when you hear that, there's Adonai. Adonai is the Lord, all right? You will keep on hearing this word.
David, Adonai.
Song in Hebrew. I always think that Hebrew is a beautiful language. Yes, because God created us. God created Hebrew. God created Israel nation. And God created Hebrew. And God wants to, want his people to praise him, to pray to him by using Hebrew language. So I really encourage you. Some of you, I know, you learn. You are bilingual. You know Chinese, Mandarin, and you know English. Some of you know Spanish, all right? In the future, when you grow up and you go to the college, if you have any opportunity, if your college offer the Hebrew, I would encourage you to learn a little bit more about the Hebrew. But because right now we don't have this environment, so it's hard for us to learn. You may want to learn not only Hebrew, but also you want to learn the Greek, so that when you read the New Testament, you can read the original written in Greek. Or when you read the Old Testament, you can read in Hebrew. How wonderful it is. The second song I'm going to share with you is from a person. He is a singer, but he is a messianic believer. He is in Israel, okay? In Israel, when the Jewish Christian call themselves as messianic followers, all right? Because in Israel, people use Hebrew. They are waiting for Messiah. So they call themselves as Jesus' follower. They said to themselves is messianic believer. All right? And the background of this song is in the square of the Wailing Wall that's on the screen, in Jerusalem, Israel. All right? And this wall in front of you, it's about 50 meters wide. It's about 18 meters high. And this is the only remaining site of the Second Temple wall remained in the world. All right? Who built the first temple? King Solomon. King Solomon built the first temple, but the first temple was destroyed by Babylonia in 586 BC, and 40,000 of Israelites were exiled to the Babylon. And after 70 years of the captivity under the king of Persia, and his name is Cyrus, he gave the order. He gave the order that all the Israel, they can go back to your homeland and build your own temple. So the first batch of the Israels went back to their hometown, and they started rebuild the temple. And the second, that is called the second temple. And the second temple was built on the base of the first temple. But unfortunately, the second temple was damaged, was totally destroyed by whom? By the Roman general, and his name is Titus, in 70 AD. That was like 600 years later, all right? And because of this, Titus destroyed, burned down all the temple, okay? Burned down all the temple. And also, he killed a lot of Israel, killed a lot of Jewish, thousands of the Jewish. And also, he expelled all the Jewish, most of the Jewish, from Palestine. That means they don't allow them to return. They don't allow them to live in the Palestine. So they were expelled from Palestine, and they can never be returned to their hometown. Not until the Eastern Roman Empire allowed the Jewish people come back to their hometown once a year only. So countless of the Jewish people, they return to their hometown on the Sabbath day every year, and they wept against the wall. So that's the name of this wall is called Wept Wall, okay? It's called Welding Wall. So for thousands of years, sunrise, sunset, sunny days, rainy days, maybe snow days, every day, thousands of years. And many, many people came back to this wall and cry, and they touched the wall. They touched the wall. So the stone of the welding wall also glowed like weeping. And we will see the next slide. See the next slide, and the people pray, and they touch the wall by using two hands. They cry, all right? And the next slide, and then they put there's a prayer's request between the two stones in the crack, all right? And once in a while, they will collect all the prayer request and bury it somewhere close to this place, okay? All right, so let's see. The next song, let's listen to the next song. And you see people, when they pray in the video, when you see the people, they pray, they move their body back and forth, move the body. That's because Hebrew belief, people believe when they read Torah or when they read the Bible, their spirit will be lit up by God's spirit, just like the light of the candle. The light of candle is like moving, right? A kind of front and back moving. So,
Elohai, Shilki Gadol, Elohai,
We Christian, we praise our Lord by music, from our heart, from our spirit, from our soul. And when I see, every time when I see the worship teams are standing here, and you know what, I was so enjoying the worship team. When you sing, my spirit just lit up, just like the light of the kingdom. I really enjoy it, and I hope that our life, your life, regardless of how old you are, your life is full of God joyfulness, right? Okay, now, this is the Book of Song background. Let's go to the lesson 8, the background of the New Testament. The last book of the Old Testament is Malachi. That is the last prophet, all right? And he is minor prophet. Do you know what is the difference between major prophet and the minor prophet? Yeah, minor is very short, right? So the first book of the New Testament is Matthew, book of Matthew. So for your Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, the last book of the Malachi, the last book, Malachi, and the first book, Matthew, is only one page difference, right? It's only one page. You just flip the page, and then you become the new, you are in the New Testament. But in the long history, it is like 400 years in the gray area, And Israel people, Israelites, they are allowed to return to their hometown to build up, to rebuild their temple, to rebuild the wall. However, they cannot reestablish their own country. There's no Israel country, nation of Israel, until 1948. So during this long time, there is a 400 years, silent years. That is between the Malachi and the Matthew time frame, 400 years. We call it the 400 years silent. What does that mean? That means in the 400 years, God did not give any inspiration to his people. God did not speak anything to his people. However, in another sense, it is also the loud year. It's not quiet year. It is also a loud year. Why? Because God's finger is stirring the world. Israel was destroyed by Babylon. And after Babylon, the world power shifted to Persian Empire. And after Persian Empire, the world power shifted to Greek Empire. And after that, it is about 100 years, very short time, that is the kingdom of Israel. However, the nation, the powerful nation, doesn't allow the Israel continue to be a country. So very soon, after 100 years, about 100 years later, Roman took over. The power of the Roman took over from Greek. So Roman become the worldwide powerful country. And of course, Palestine become under the Romans' rule. All right? But all these years, this 400 years, God didn't keep silent, because far back to 200 years ago, when there was a king, and he is the king of Babylon, and his name is, this is very difficult for me to pronounce, I'll try to pronounce that, Nebuchadnezzar, thank you, Nebuchadnezzar. He dreamed a dream, but he cannot remember this dream. But this dream really disturbed him. He couldn't sleep. He woke up, and the next day, he summoned all the countries, learned people, and they can interpret the dream. And tell them, you must interpret the dream I dreamed last night. So they said, of course, king, we can do that, but you must tell me what the dream was. And the king said, I cannot remember. I cannot tell you what the dream is, but you must tell me what do I dream. And also you need to tell me what is the meaning of the dream. And nobody can interpret the dream unless there is one person, and his name is Daniel. And this dream was recorded in the book of Daniel, chapter 2. You can go home and read this story, all right? And the dream was about 400 years, silent years. Let's watch this video.
For us today. The dream featured a huge statue of a man whose splendor was excellent and its form was awesome. Did you know that the prophetic dream that Nebuchadnezzar had in Daniel chapter 2 could have potential implications for us today? The dream featured a huge statue of a man whose splendor was excellent and its form was awesome. And the head of the statue was of gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, and its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. Each section represented a kingdom, and the head of gold was one of those kingdoms of Babylon, ruled by Nebuchadnezzar himself. The second section, the chest and arms of silver, was to be a second inferior kingdom, which we are told in Daniel 5 was the Medo-Persian Empire. The third kingdom, the belly and thighs of bronze, was Greece, ruled by Alexander the Great. And the fourth kingdom, the legs of iron, was undoubtedly Rome. The fifth kingdom, however, is the feet of iron and clay. And that is the kingdom that will be smashed by the rock, bringing down all the other kingdoms before it, Daniel 2:34. Now, while opinions differ on who this last empire is, most Christians believe that this is to be the Antichrist kingdom, the final kingdom, which is spoken of in Revelation chapter 17, verses 12 and 13. Here the Antichrist leads a coalition of 10 nations, which is in verse 14, is defeated by Christ, who then sets up his eternal kingdom, where the kingdoms of the world become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, Revelation 11, 15. Jesus said there will be signs to help us identify the time of the end and of his return. We can rely on the prophetic picture of the statue in Daniel to tell us what the nature of this last kingdom will be, partly strong with attributes of the Iron Kingdom of Rome, for example, and yet with clear weaknesses that come from a divided kingdom. Does this sound familiar? Our hope is secure, though, as the book of Daniel in chapter 2, verse 44, finishes this particular prophecy with these words. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to another people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of a mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure. The implications to us in this generation is that we are in that last ruling power, and we need to be aware that Christ's kingdom is soon to come.
So this 400 years has already been prophesied 200 years ago, by Daniel. So, through Daniel, by God. So, Babylon was destroyed. No more Babylon. Persia was destroyed. No more Persia. Greek, no more exist. Empire. Roman. What about the Roman? Rome. In the book of Micah, would you please, the PowerPoint, turn to the Bible verse Micah 5:2? Micah is a minor prophet too. What did he say? He prophesies that, someone can read for me, for everyone? Can someone read? Zheng Yue, okay. Yeah, read aloud. Ephrathah. So, in this Bible verse, who is that one? Out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel. Who is that person? Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ will be born in Bethlehem that was prophesied in the Old Testament. All right? So, when we learn about the New Testament, the background, we cannot ignore the Old Testament, because throughout the Old Testament, all the Old Testament is pointing out one very important stone. That stone smashed all the empires, smashed the world, and that stone is Messiah. That stone is Jesus Christ. Right? So from the prophecy point of view, we know in the New Testament, Jesus was born under Rome's rule. This has already been prophesied, all right? And then, when Jesus, during the captivity time, during the captivity, after 70 years, all the Jewish people, they were allowed to go back to the homeland, and a group of the people, they are so heartbroken. They were so sad. And they swear to God that they will never sin against God, and that they will never worship the false God, and that they will always, always follow God's rule. They will always strictly find the law and the ceremony. And they believe if they obey God's rule, they will enter to the kingdom of heaven sooner, faster. And this group of the people we call Pharisee. Can we go to the next slide? The Pharisee and let me see which one. The one before this. The one before. And before this. Yes, Pharisee. They are law keeper because they believe if they observe, if they obey the law, they can go to the heaven. But another group of the people, they hate to be ruled or under Romans' control. And this group of the people, they are extreme. They are terrorists. Okay, so they call Zealot. One of Jesus' disciples is Zealot. Go back in the check, research. Yes, Max. We are going to learn the Bible history, New Testament history, four books next week. No, a week, follow next week. You can tell me what is the Jesus' disciples' name. And he is one of the zealot. And another group of the people is Sadducee. Sadducee is a compromiser. No. We have to be peacefully lived under Rome's control. We live in this country. We live in this territory. All right? And the Roman people, they are my friend. They are our friend. So we needed to work with them. We needed to be harmoniously living with them. So they are called Sadducee. And usually Sadducees is in the upper level of the society. They are very wealthy and they have the power, political power. And like a Pharisee, they strictly follow the rule, religious person. So they keep away themselves from the Roman government. They keep themselves from the politics. They just they are lawyer, they are law keeper. But Sadducee, they are businessmen. And they are in the higher rank of the society. And during Jesus' time, the high priest is Sadducee. So we see during Jesus' time, Sadducee and the Pharisees, they are friends, or they are always against to each other. What do you think? The Sadducee and the Pharisee, are they friends? No, because the Pharisee, they believe eternal life and they believe resurrection. But Sadducee, they don't believe eternal life and they do not believe the kingdom, the heaven, all right? So they have different philosophy, they have different theory. So that is the different group of Jews under Roman government. That is also the background of the New Testament. So next week, the 2 weeks later, when we read the history of the New Testament, we will see a lot of conflict between Jesus and those people. All right? Okay. So the next difference is the territory change. Remember last time we have a homework, and one of the homework is to draw the map about 12 tribes. Do you still remember? All right. But during the Romans' time, this 12 tribes, this is in the left side, it no more exist. So they divided the territory, the Palestine, into five different groups. Okay, the first The left is 12 tribes, and the right side is division of the nation. The division of nation, the entire Palestine place area divided to north and the south, right? The north is Israel, the kingdom of Israel, and the south is Judah, all right? Judah, the kingdom of Judah. So this is during the division time, during division time. The next slide is during Jesus' time. The whole the area is still the same, but there are five territory. The north one in the north is Galilee. you have to pay. This is one of your homework, okay? If you want to take your cell phone to take a picture, you can take a picture, but I don't encourage you to do that. I would rather you go home and do the research and draw the map, okay? So drawing another map like this is your homework. So the north, there are five parts of the territory. The first is Galilee, and the middle is Samaria, and the south is Judea, and the east part, the east territory is Decapolis, and the southeast is Perea. Okay, that is during the Jesus time, the Palestine divided into five areas. But Jesus, most of the Jesus travel area is Galilee, Samaria, and Judea. Okay? All right, the next few pictures are the life. What's the life in Jesus' time? But this is, you see the boat. This is today's boat. Huh? When you go to the Israel, when you go, this is in Galilee. You wanted to see the scenery of Galilee. This is the boat for the tourist. Okay, I have been to Israel in 2018, so I was in this boat before. Okay. All right, the next slide. This is the fish, and very popular from Galilee, the Lake of the Galilee, okay? And that is called, it's similar to today's tilapia. You can ask your mother or father, what is a tilapia about in Chinese? That's 乌锅鱼,不知道你们听过没?好,乌锅鱼。然后呢, or in the Israel, people call this fish as a Peter, the fish of Peter, 彼得鱼, Peter fish, or the fish of Peter. Yeah, I ate this one in the hotel. It's pretty, they hire the Chinese cook. Most of the hotel, they have a Chinese kitchen, Chinese cook. So they cook Chinese food for the tourist. Okay, the next slide. Next slide, please. All right, that is the food usually people eat during Jesus' time. Pomegranate, olive, fig, and the pita, and the tomato, cucumber. So all these you're familiar with. Now we also eat this kind of food in the United States. The next slide. That is the dress in Jesus' time people wear. Okay, it looks familiar with you. All right, next slide. That is the sandal Jesus used to wear, all right? This sandal is for men, and there is a female sandal similar like the next slide. This is a female sandal. So that's why Jesus said that the dirtiest part of the body is what? It's your feet. So washing someone's feet is very, very courteous way to greet theirs. Friend, the first thing when your friend visit you, the maid is washing the guest's feet, all right? Because they wear the sandal, and in the Middle East, the ground is not, it's like this, sandy ground, all right? So their feet are easy to get dirt. It's very dusty, so they wash the feet. And Jesus want us to wash our feet, to wash the feet for each other, one another. Right, because he said, who wants to be the leader? Who needs to serve people first? So before Jesus died, he washed his disciples' feet, right? The next. This is Jesus' birthplace. I have been here. It looks like the stable is underground. So when you enter to Jesus' birthplace, you have to go through the stairs. This is the entrance of the stables, okay? Next one, after this stairs, it's like this. You see people line up, actually they are from the upper level and they come down here. And there's a woman kneeled down and the worship and the kneeled down in front of a kind of fireplace, right? And that exact place is where the stables is, okay? All right, the next one. That's the one, that's the picture. All right, you see the, just like a fireplace, that the center with the stars, metal stars, that is where exactly Jesus, how do you call that, Martel Stables? Next, first place. And this is in Nazareth. And Jesus' birthplace is in Bethlehem, but he grew up in Nazareth. So this is the ancient plow. The next one. Have you seen the farmer or the peasant tilling the soil? So this is the plow. They use the plow. The next one. This is Jesus' childhood home at Nazareth. Next. And this is the Jordan River. Jesus got baptized exactly, that is what they said, but I am not very sure because I was not born that time, but I did baptize over here. You see a crowd of the people, they wear the white gown, and they are waiting to be baptized. Jesus, according to what they said, Jesus was exactly baptized here by John Baptist. Where the place? Oops. You know there are two trees, before two trees, before that tree, there are a group of people wear the white gown. You cannot see it? Too far. Oh, okay. But that is the place. That's where exact the place Jesus got baptized. So we, as a group, that time we are in the old church, we came here and we baptized here too. Even though I have baptized before, I still do one more time. Just kind of experience, okay? But I know I'm saved. I'm very sure I'm saved. Next one. This is the model of the temple. Because the temple has already been demolished, has already been destroyed. There's no more temple. Even right now, the site of the temple, the first temple and the second temple. Now, right now, is the Muslims' mosque temple, Muslims' temple, okay, not the Jewish temple. So this is a model of the temple. The next one. This is the open tomb of Jesus. All right? So we will spend more time and learn about Jesus' history next time. That is today's lesson, the background of the New Testament. And this is the homework. Thank you. All right, would you please pass it? This is today's homework. Okay. Yeah, pass it down. All right, I did not give you too much homework because I want you to focus on the Bible book memory. You must, right now, I think you already memorized all the Old Testament, right? All the books of the Old Testament. And the next week, please memorize the first four books of the history of New Testament. The first five books, that's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the book of John, and Acts. That's five books, together with the 39 name of the Bible book in the Old Testament. So spend more time of this, memorizing the Bible book name, and the next week we'll use 45 minutes, we will practice, we will play with all these card with Bible book name. All right, last time we don't have much time to do that, but next time you will earn a lot of raffle tickets. Okay? All right, that's today's lesson. Thanks God. Praise the Lord. We finished.